Hello and welcome to this International Women's Day webcast. We're being brought to you live through the generous support of Redback Conferencing, and they have provided the facilities and the technology to us and have helped us pull this event together in less than a week, and we're very grateful. My name is Georgina Dent and I'm the contributing editor of Women's Agenda. We have three fabulous women here today to discuss how the new federal laws will leave women and children worse off, and I'll introduce each of them now. So we've got Dr. Cassandra Goldie, who is the CEO of the Australian Council of Social Services, which is the peak body for the community services sector in Australia. She is a strong advocate for action to reduce poverty and inequality.
Hi, Georgie.
Hi, Cass. We've got Samantha Page down the end, who is the CEO of Early Childhood Australia, the peak advocacy body for children under eight, their families and early childhood professionals. And then finally, next to me, we've got Professor Marian Baird, who is the co-director of the Women, Work and Leadership Research Group at the University of Sydney Business School. She is an expert on women and leadership, on paid parental leave schemes and organisational responses to the changing gender and age demographics of the workforce. Welcome to three
G'day.
Of you.
Hello. Happy International Women's Day.
I know, I know.
To everybody.
So, look, together we're going to unpack what's been going on with the proposed changes to childcare subsidies, to paid parental leave, family tax benefits, and a series of measures that, if they come to pass, we have reason to believe they will leave women and children worse off. Mostly this has revolved around the government's promise 3 years ago to fix childcare, even though it does feel like longer than 3 years. Am I alone in feeling that? But the combination of making those promises and the determination to make budget savings have combined and put us in the position we're in currently. Before we get into the substantive conversation, I just wanted to say that there will be an opportunity to ask questions. So if you have any questions at this point, feel free to type them in and they'll come up, and at 3:15 we will get through as many as possible. So the current situation is that the government has combined the Jobs for Families childcare package bill into a welfare savings bill. And it includes reducing the amount of paid parental leave that's available to women, and seeks further cuts to family tax benefits. This bill has passed the lower house twice and been referred to a Senate committee inquiry. You can find a link to the submissions to that inquiry on the site of this webcast. Some of the crossbench senators are talking about splitting the bills. And to help us to understand that a little bit more, I'd like to ask Samantha Page why you think these bills should be separated.
Sure. So Early Childhood Australia and many others in the early childhood sector believe the package should never have been brought together with the welfare spending cuts and the changes to paid parental leave. Investment in early childhood education is not a welfare spend. It's an investment in education of young children and an investment in workforce participation. The economic modelling that was done by PricewaterhouseCoopers specifically on the childcare package as proposed in the legislation demonstrates that it pays for itself within 3 to 4 years. It really should not be linked to or reliant on cuts in other areas in order to pass the childcare reform legislation, and it should be dealt with separately on its merits, and we've been pretty clear about that from the beginning. So we're very disappointed to see the childcare package in the omnibus bill.
Mm-hmm. Cass, ACOS has expressed some concerns as well about these bills. Can you talk to me about that concern?
Well, really serious concern, Georgie. I think, I mean, the big picture here, it's important for us to ground this discussion, is we do an analysis about the level of poverty in Australia. So almost 3 million people are living below the poverty line in Australia, despite being a very wealthy country and over 20 years of pretty strong economic growth. And we have 730,000 kids living below the poverty line. One of the groups most adversely affected by not having enough are absolutely single-parent households. And over 80% of those households are headed by women. And in those households, 40% of the kids are living in poverty. So we should be really, really concerned, be scrutinising carefully the big discussion about where savings should be made, what we should be doing with the budget. Of course, that's how this has all been framed up. The World Economic Forum said just last week the biggest risk to economic strength of a country is growing inequality. So let us get this clear. This is about good economics, good social outcomes as well. The government has been relentlessly pursuing welfare cuts. We have ACOS, this is our area of expertise. We have promoted and support a range of savings. I won't go through them all now, but roughly we think that we have delivered in conjunction with the government, about $20 billion in savings for what might have been seen as welfare that was not well targeted, something like the part pension for age pensioners, clawing back the assets test. This bill contains welfare cuts that we say and we know will directly hit the incomes of the lowest income families, including single parents and their children. And so we've had a big contest in the Parliament about it. You're quite right. We've at this point in time got enough crossbenchers to say they've looked at the detail. They are not prepared to support those measures, the family payment cuts. There's another one, the pensioner education supplement. Many women are affected by that. These are all measures that will particularly hit women. And, of course, they say, well, you've got to do that because if you want your investment in childcare. They haven't been doing that on some of the other measures, and I'm happy to talk about the gender, gendered issues here. Tax cut that was delivered last year for people on $80,000 and over, benefits mainly higher income men. Nobody had to find savings, amongst higher income men in order to fund that. So this is a very gendered picture as we see it as well.
And I think the fact that it is International Women's Day today, and I think it's worth noting that in no uncertain terms,
Absolutely.
That these are seen as women's issues and they're being couched as welfare spends when that's not actually how they necessarily ought to be characterised. Marian, another welfare measure that I don't think should be defined as welfare, but it is paid parental leave. So currently, the bill allows women to claim up to 18 weeks of leave at the minimum pay, as well as any employer-funded entitlements that they get. This, as you know, has been offensively labelled as double-dipping, even though it was actually part of the rationale for the introduction of a minimum wage scheme in the first place. What would be the impact of these proposed changes to paid parental leave on women?
Yes, well, look, first of all, let me start by saying, I mean, one of the big issues is this problem about calling it a welfare payment, as you've observed, because the current parental leave scheme is really designed around two primary objectives. And one is to increase women's participation in the paid workforce. And as Cass has said, these sort of issues about participation, productivity and economic growth are always examined by think tanks, big corporates around the world, and they all say to increase Australia's GDP, to increase our productivity, we need to increase the number of women in the paid workforce. So on the one hand, we've got that policy objective. And then on the other hand, we've got this omnibus bill lumping areas that will really affect both women's ability to participate but also increase inequality. So what I do want to say here is that I think it's an incredible shame and a terrible indictment on policy development in Australia that we now have pieces of legislation that had been carefully thought out in the past lumped together in this one bill and seem to be really having to fight each other. So that's probably why we all need to separate them again and say the issues are very clear. These are three separate areas that all need careful attention. In a policy sense, we need to link them, but we don't need to trade one off against the other.
Absolutely not.
That's really important. So back to what would happen. So if the paid parental leave changes go through, women would lose, just the headline, any woman who works for hospital or teachers at the moment or works in the public services of the various states and the federal government will lose somewhere up from $9,400. They'll just lose that straight out because that will be cut from their parental leave payment they currently receive from the government.
Mm-hmm.
if you work in the private sector and, for example, say your company offered 10 weeks paid parental leave to supplement the minimum payment through the government scheme, those employees will lose $6,700 to $7,000 straight up. So these are enormous cuts. We're talking about a lot of money that not just women have factored into the planning for having children, and but so have their whole households. And so if we think about the implications of that, first of all, there's a cut to their income when they have a new member of the family. So obviously there's already pressure in the household. Mm-hmm. If there's a cut to income, people then, and we know from the research, that the biggest incentive, the biggest motivating factor to return to work is actually loss of income. People will be forced back into the workforce earlier with younger children, which puts immediate pressure back on the childcare system. So this it's a really ludicrous situation we're now in. And you know, the paid parental leave bill was not developed out of thin air. It's had decades of preparation. We have evaluated it. The Productivity Commission has worked on it. We have had Senate inquiries into it. We know it's working well. So to now unravel it and unpack it is a really sorry state of affairs. And, you know, I'm just shocked that Australia's got to that point, and that on International Women's Day 2017, we still have to argue the case for these, what around the world are actually seen as legitimate public policies.
I mean, Marian, Georgie, you may not know this, but actually Marian and I worked very closely together back at the point of the very early design and thinking that was being done around the fact that at that point Australia had virtually no statutory paid...
We had no
statutory paid parental leave scheme whatsoever. And I was working at the Human Rights Commission with Liz Broderick, the Sex Discrimination Commissioner at the time, and this was very carefully designed. When it was delivered by the government at the time, it was always seen as being a first stage. It was always seen as a first minimum step in the right direction. And when, you know, the former Prime Minister, Tony Abbott, was promoting the so-called Roll Gold scheme, we said his framing of it, it was right. He said it is a workplace entitlement. We should be trying to secure 6 months income replacement. The debate was how you finance that.
That's right.
And in the early design of it, there was always an expectation that once the first stage was implemented, that there would be the evaluation, a test to see what was the reaction from employers, how it was delivering on expected outcomes, you know, both benefits for, you know, babies and for parents. And then we would have a further look, not about how to claw it back, but actually how to finance getting us to where we really want to be.
Because it's a very modest scheme. It's a very low level of paid parental leave in Australia compared to other countries.
And
it does beg a belief to me that that impact on babies is completely missing. It's missing from the evaluation. It's missing from the legislation. It's certainly missing from the rationale for changing the scheme. There's just no recognition that World Health Organization recommendations have been incontrovertible for a long time, that babies should have 26 weeks at home with their parents. And and look, if they come into childcare younger than that, we will do our very best to give them the best possible start. But ideally, they stay at home with their parents for 26 weeks, and that's what we should be aiming for.
But that is a genuine, real option for families and parents. And
Without asking people to impoverish themselves or sell the house to fund it.
That's right. You know, we knew that there were women who were being forced back to work within weeks, weren't they, Marian?
Yeah,
because
that's right.
Because there was absolutely no income guarantee if they, you know, took time at home with their baby, new baby.
Yeah, and I think the point that you have all raised is that this, you could be forgiven if you flip through the newspapers over the last two years. You could be forgiven for thinking that there has been no research in this area, that, that we are not equipped to manage these issues. The reality is all countries have been managing women working and having children for a number of years, and Australia is, in OECD terms, we really are lagging. Absolutely. I think America is the only country that's behind us in terms of our paid parental leave payments.
Right.
And it is quite extraordinary to consider that we have what was proposed as the starting point is now being wound back, potentially.
Right.
And again, it seems that there is very little understanding on the part of the, and I might be mistaken here, but on the part of the decision makers. They seem to be blind to these consequences. Cass, you have touched on this.
We might add to that that the decision makers in this bill are all men.
Hmm. Yes.
Oh, well, that's a shared theme from all of us. Yeah. Shouldn't have escaped anybody that the senior ministers responsible for the design of all of these measures are all men.
Mm. Yes, we need to take note of that. And that also feeds into the question that I was going to ask you, Cass, which you have touched on, but it is... Across the board, these changes to family tax benefits, to the childcare system, to paid parental leave, they do seem to be having a disproportionate impact on women. So there does seem to be a sort of gender blindness in a sense. Can you talk about how you see that, how these proposed changes?
So look, just earlier today I was at an event being hosted by the Australian Financial Review, the Business Summit.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, over there there are very, significant, powerful voices continuing to prosecute the, we need to get a cut to the company tax rate.
Mm.
Now, if you get into the sophisticated economic analysis, for the cost that will be to the budget, there is a serious question over the value for the return.
Mm-hmm.
There is nowhere near the debate going on about that in contrast to seriously good investment in the areas that we're talking about. And Marian's alluded to that. The economic analysis that's been done about the GDP lift to really supporting, women's workforce participation without trading off the well-being of children and families. So we've got this perception, and it's a reality, that on the one hand... governments, and they are, being led by male leaders at this time, who are persistently prosecuting the notion that you just need to lower taxes. Thank you very much. We'll take a tax cut if we're on high incomes, mostly men, and this cut to the company tax rate. But in these areas, it is again like, sorry, women, you've really got to, step up, trade off, do the hard work. give up something in order to give up, in order to get something. Mm. Now, none of us ever wanted to be in that position. No. That is not the way to do good policy.
Mm.
But I really think it's important for us to call this, to say this is what we are seeing, I don't think it's escaping the people in the community who see this very uneven approach. And if there is one thing that we, don't talk enough about, in terms of the well-being of community, how do we build resilient societies? We've got a, concern about some of the, debates going on in Australian society. Creating enough capacity for people to spend time with people they love, spend time with people they care, really is important.
Mm.
And that's not to, be just soft-hearted. That is a human need. And at the same time, for us to get the right balance in terms of the investment. And in these areas we're talking about, early childhood education and care, and the early years for children, whether you're talking to a social policy expert or an economic expert or, frankly, the Gonski panel, they all said this has to be a top priority for Australia because we really are lagging behind. I mean, we shouldn't accept the fact that when by the time children get to primary school, we're going to always have the higher level of children hitting primary school with the level of disadvantage that we are currently seeing.
Mm.
We can really change that, but we've got to get these policies right.
That's right.
Mm. Well, we're probably all showing our age by, how many times were we told 20, 15, 10 years ago, you have to have the evidence. There just isn't the evidence about what
true.
Works or what policy would be effective in these areas. We've got so much evidence now, it's coming out of our ears, and yet it's just not considered legitimate or the policies aren't connecting to the research. I mean, the research into the value of investing in early learning is completely, you cannot argue against it. It's the strongest research I've ever seen. And yet it's not, doesn't seem to be influencing policy in the way you would expect it to influence policy. It does seem to be a an ideological debate as much as it is a debate about evidence. And if I have one more minister in a suit in his 50s, tell me what has to happen to get women back to work. As a mother, as a single parent, as someone who is heading up an organisation that's been advocating for women's workforce participation for 75 years, I think we have a really informed opinion about that. And we could be providing a lot of good advice on how to construct the package, how to make paid parental leave work how to address inequality and improve outcomes for young children. But we're just not being listened to. I feel frustrated that we're not being listened to.
And look, I share that frustration, and I think that across the board, because I listen to what each of you say and I think about this in the context of women in businesses as well, and I think there's so much compelling evidence that a more diverse leadership group creates more profit. And, you know, that's just one aspect. That's not the reason why we should have more diverse leadership, but it's there. Businesses, you would think, would be compelled by that sort of, by the financial imperative, but they're not. Well, and it takes me, it brings me to the point that I don't think the solutions are beyond us, but it does seem that the intent to implement those solutions is beyond us. Sam, can I ask you to elaborate a little bit on your on the opposition to the childcare bill as it stands?
Yep.
How is it going to impact children and why is that not acceptable?
Sure. So overall, we do support the direction that the bill is taking childcare subsidies. So anybody who's had anything to do with the delivery of early childhood education and care or using children's services would know that the current system is something of a basket case with multiple subsidies that nobody, despite how familiar you might be with the system, can actually calculate with any accuracy what one family might be eligible for. It's just far too complicated. And so the bill that's in the Parliament at the moment takes that very complex system, streamlines payments into a single subsidy, and then applies a work activity test and a means test at the same time, which will see the subsidy a lot more generous for low and middle income working families, a bit less generous for very high income families, but we are talking over $300,000 per annum in household income. And most families, in fact, we estimate that 3 out of 4 families that are using childcare will be better off under the new system. The caveats on it are that the emphasis is very much on workforce participation. It's really dropped what we used to call the dual pillar of child development. So we used to talk about early childhood education and care as achieving two goals. One is about child development, one is about workforce participation. And this package seems to be too weighted towards workforce participation. And that means that it's reduced access to childcare subsidies for families that aren't meeting a much more demanding activity test than currently applies to the childcare rebate. So under the new system, both parents have to be working or studying or volunteering. There are a few different definitions of activity, but both parents need to be meeting it, and they need to be meeting it all of the time. And so what we're concerned about is the families that are in insecure work, casual work, contract work, in between jobs for a given time, and what that will mean for children's participation if they're in and out of services, if they're dropping in and out of eligibility for subsidy. The other thing we're concerned about is the safety net. So there is a minimum amount of 12 hours a week for families under $65,000 in household income. So that is low-income families, a minimum of 12 hours a week. 12 hours a week just isn't enough. It's not enough to provide 2 days a week of a quality early learning program. So it really needs to increase to at least 15 hours, which is the preschool equivalent. We'd like to see it higher. 18 hours would be even better. And then the other area of safety that we're concerned about is the children in rural or remote areas and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children. So we know that there are big barriers to access and participation in rural or remote areas. And the way those services have been funded in the past is through a block grant funding model and moving them on on to a mainstream subsidy system is problematic, and we need the government to address that in this package and come up with a better strategy for ensuring rural and remote services are available. Mm-hmm. And then Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children, we know, are twice as likely to start school vulnerable on more than one developmental domain, and they very rarely catch up from that. And so as a consequence, they're less likely to do well at school, to enjoy school, to get the benefit out of school that the other children enjoy, and to go on and complete school and go on to tertiary or trade qualification training. So I think that's been long identified, that getting better early education for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children is a national priority, needs to be a national priority. We need a higher safety net in terms of number of hours for Aboriginal children, because a lot of them are in mainstream services, so a higher number of hours, but also security and sustainability for the Aboriginal services that are operating around the country, which are used by a lot of Aboriginal families. And so so these are aspects of the bill that can be changed. Mm-hmm. So the bill can be amended. Mm-hmm. We've proposed some amendments. We've worked with the government on those amendments. It's not, we're not blocking the legislation, but there are some important amendments that are needed to make it fair.
And what I mean, this could, and could still, because it hasn't been legislated yet, so there's still time, and that's why we're here. This could be reworked to deliver on the best expertise right across, you know, the country and globally around early learning for children, which is there are huge benefits to be gained by children accessing a minimum of 2 days per week. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, 2017. That is well understood. We see, of course, high-income families who will, of course, be having their children at the right age going into early learning opportunities because they know it's great for early learning, you know, developmental needs. And so this idea that the only way you can access it, the government support to do that, is if you are in workforce participation arrangements completely cuts out, you know, that guarantee. That's what we should be working to in Australia. In a country like Australia, this is absolutely doable. But the government is, you know, you're saying, Sam, has a single focus, it seems, on, you know, well, if you're going to get be allowed to put your kids into, you know, early learning opportunities, you've got to pay for it by going to work.
Well, it's also it's out of touch with the reality of people's lives. It's not like you can put your name down on the casual roster at Coles, get the call, and say, oh, I'll just sort out childcare. I'll just find a childcare spot and put my child in for the day in a place where they've never been before, with educators they've never met before. That's just not reality. That's not how it works. And we have one in four, Marian, you were saying, women in the workforce are in casual or part-time work arrangements. They need to have childcare in place already before they are able to go and put their name down for more shifts or to take up the extra work that they might be looking for. It's just the wrong way around to see it as an incentive, that if you get more work, then you'll get more childcare subsidy. That just, to me, that's wrong-headed.
It's not real world.
It's not real world. It's not in touch with people's lives. We need to. What we know is that the majority of single mother households, the mother is working. What we know is most women feel underemployed when they're in casual and part-time arrangements. It's not. There's no need to incentivise work. Women want to work, but you've got to make it possible. And to make it possible, children need to go somewhere that's they're feeling safe, secure. Yeah. It's regular. They know the educators. They know the other children. They're settled, and work can happen. Instead of this idea that we're going to take it away from you when you lose a shift or when you're on a part-time contract. Now, I know there are some, I don't want to oversimplify it, there are some clauses in the legislation that will allow for people on casual and contract work, but I don't think it's enough. I think it would be so much easier if we could say, you know what, 2 days a week for children, and then if you're working, you can have more days. I also just want to be clear that we're not here saying all children should go 2 days a week from the time that they're tiny little babies. That's not the argument at all. The argument is that if children are going to attend early learning, they should get at least 2 days so that they have regular participation. It's still an option for families.
That's right.
It's not a compulsion, and we're not advocating 5 days a week. Do you know what I mean? It's 2 days a week that we know children can cope with and they'll benefit from, and that can be a regular level of participation.
And I mean, in terms of my understanding of the research, is that for vulnerable children, that's where you actually get the richest return on the investment in early learning, which is why having that sort of framework for those for children that are in that category. Yes. It makes it, it's a compelling case for doing that.
That's right, particularly in those critical 2 years before school. If children can get, it should be higher, 3 or 4 days, in those 2 years before school, you can actually equalise opportunity. You can actually overcome the vulnerability that those children might walk in the door with before they transition to school. So that's really significant. But also for younger children, they're often coming from vulnerable families, and having 2 days a week of stability in a quality program with good relationships with educators can also be a very beneficial experience. And it stabilises families that are vulnerable, are often in insecure housing, insecure work. They've got a lot of things to do just to get through the week. So providing that support to them, it's not particularly expensive, and it works. And I think that we'll see the lift in workforce participation that's predicted. We will. We'll see more people working more hours as a result of the subsidy reform. But there's no need to cut loose those vulnerable families. We can afford to support them too.
Marian, I wanted to talk to you now about the, because another issue that comes up a lot with casual work, the casualised workforce in particular, is pay equity. It tends to be lower paid jobs when it's a casual, the basis on which you're working. I'm interested to know from you, how do you think the recent penalty rates decision will impact women? What is the likely impact there?
Yes, well, the penalty rates decision is another example, unfortunately, of a policy that will have a more negative effect on women, because that's where women tend to work. So women cluster into what we call feminised industries, and two of those are hospitality and retail. So that's the first issue. We know there are more women in those sectors, 55 to 56, 57%. The second issue is that because of the childcare pressures, women often opt for weekend work when their partners or other family members can do the care. So now we're seeing a double hit, in a sense, on these women. They're working unsociable hours and they're missing out on family time. And the time use research does show that weekend work is detrimental to people's social relations. Sunday work particularly, and that work on Sundays and the family time or community time you lose is never recaptured if you work on a Sunday. And that could make that makes sense to all of us. What happens on a Sunday doesn't happen on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday or Saturday. So there is a penalty for those women already working those days. So to cut the penalty rate will affect women. Now, penalty rates were originally introduced for two reasons. One, they were a deterrent to companies to open on the days that the community felt were days for the family and community, so Saturday and Sunday, and then more latterly Sunday. And secondly, they were to provide some compensation to people who worked on those days for the fact that they were missing out on regular family and social time. So what this decision is really also saying is that those women, or anyone who works on those days, is no longer missing out on that family time, which I find a bit paradoxical, because if we're arguing that we've move to a 24/7 society, and so people don't go to church on Sundays now, but they use it to go and eat out together or shop together. Isn't that community time too? But we're saying that the people who work those days shouldn't be compensated for the time they spend at work. So it will have an impact. It'll have an impact on women who are already in low-paid jobs. These are often women who have downgraded their jobs because they need the more flexible hours and because they need the care on the weekend. So I am really disappointed to see that decision, and I think we will see women having to do one of two things: either decide not to work on the Sunday or actually have to increase their hours in order to meet their financial commitments.
And of course, you know, we know that we've got a gender pay gap in Australia. Maybe the last time I checked, we haven't sorted that, have we?
No, it's still 18%, and it's actually gone up a little bit. It's hovering around there, it goes up and down a bit, but it certainly isn't decreasing.
That's right. And then in the bigger context, again, about, what's going on in terms of who is the sort of distribution or the share of the benefits of growth, of economic activity. The public is absolutely right to be seeing the fact that we've got this low growth in wages generally. They've got this downward pressure on low-paid work.
That's right.
Increasingly highly casualised.
And profit margins are huge.
That's it. And again, you know, sort of a line which is, well, you know, what we need to do as a country is cut taxes. Okay. So the outcome of this cannot be that we see low-paid workers in Australia taking home less. That cannot be the outcome. Each of us have talked about the importance of the right kind of flexibility. Right? Let us focus on the machinery that we need to get the right kind of flexibility, the reciprocity between employers and, you know, people participating in the workforce. And I come back to your point, Sam, about the barriers to greater flexibility. Part of employers' frustration is this, some of this chaos around, you know, childcare arrangements and, you know, being able to take up shifts, you know, quickly, all the rest of it. But it would be extraordinary for us to see that the next most significant reform in the sort of wages area is a further cut to the incomes of low-paid people in Australia.
Sam, two things. I'm sure you may have seen, all of you may have seen, that Fairfax Media published a piece today, which is, it's the case of a woman who is qualified as a childcare educator, but she's actually working as a cleaner at a childcare centre, and she's earning more as a cleaner than she was as an educator. This is alarming at the best of times, but it's also particularly relevant today because a lot of childcare educators are walking off the job in about 13 minutes at 3:20, I understand, because they are taking home such a little wage. Can you talk about that, Sam?
Yes. I mean, more power to those who are walking off today, and thank you to the parents who are supporting them in doing that. We've had a lot of positive commentary from parents who do understand how important the work of early childhood education is, and the fact that early childhood educators are qualified. They are required to have a Certificate 3 or a diploma or a teaching qualification, and yet they're paid very poorly in comparison to others in the teaching world and the education world, and in fact in comparison to fitter and machinists, I understand, from the article that ran on the weekend. It is really time that we recognised just how significant children's development is in the early years, how much brain development happens in the first 3 years, how critical it is that we're giving children the best possible start before they transition to school to learn the critical skills they need to engage in education. And they're not learning your ABC, they're actually learning about getting along with others, following each other's direction, cooperating, collaborating, negotiating, being able to manage your own emotions. These are the critical skills that children in that year or two before school need to learn before they transition to school. So early childhood educators are doing very important work, and it is time that we recognise that. And it's really just an accident of history that this work has been devalued in comparison to work that is, say, in the manufacturing arena or other industries, and it's time we fixed it. It requires a one-off significant adjustment to fix it. And I'm not underestimating what a significant adjustment. We have 150,000 educators in Australia. It's a big adjustment. But we are hoping there is a gender parity case before the Fair Work Commission, and we, fingers and toes crossed, that that comes to a good conclusion.
I suppose one of the difficulties is that we've seen the cost of childcare and the amount of money that parents but also the government are spending on subsidies has increased exponentially, but none of that has gone to an increase in the pay of the educators.
Some of it has. So some of the price increases are about wage increase, but that's increases to the minimum wage and flow on through the awards. So usually about half of the percentage increase in childcare fees every year is related to wage increases, but it's minimum wage increases. It's not a structural adjustment.
That's
like
right.
What we're talking about in terms of lifting wage rates to a better, a more equitable level.
Mm. Mm. I just wanted to remind people that are listening that we will be taking questions soon. So if you've got any, feel free to send those through. Cass, on that subject of the pay gap, what do you think we can do to move it?
Oh, well, let's get the list out, shall we?
Yes.
I think this the issue of the valuation of work is really one of the big outstanding agendas for all of us. Yeah. I absolutely hear what Sam says. I think the term sort of accident might be a little bit kind today.
Yes,
I thought about what kind of time that, you know, work value.
Yeah.
I think in the, if we draw a little on some of what we've seen, for example, in the US, where people in the community have watched people doing certain kinds of work who are getting paid extraordinary levels of money, the kind of executive bonuses that happen. You would know, George, yourself and Marian, you know, that we have a gender pay gap that's pretty offensive at that level, you know, when we look at the gap in terms of who gets the bonuses at the high end. And there is something that's deeply cultural in this, which just needs to be persistently called out. One of the most important things is full transparency. Now, it's not popular to talk about that, but I tell you what, having been in the rooms where a young, say, in the legal profession, I've seen it happen where we were interviewing them and the female said, oh, this is, you know, and she turned around to her male colleague and he was getting thousands more than her on the first round of pay negotiations for absolutely no reason whatsoever. And she didn't know that until that moment. And often in this it gets talked about, oh, women, you know, it's a deficit of women, of course, you know, oh, we're just not tough enough, we just don't negotiate hard enough. I go, you know, what are we trying to value here? What kind of behaviours do we want to value? What I think, and we talk about as a feminised characteristic, because I certainly don't want this to be seen as it's only women that behave in a particular way and only men that behave in another way, but in terms of behaviours, what we typically see in a feminised way is some factoring in of circumstance. I've been in workplaces in caring industries where women will factor in, if I push for more, I can see the consequence of this will be a lack of services. Why don't we actually value that and at the same time say there's a culture from the top that says we are committed to ensuring, often more male-dominated, may I say, the higher up you get decision-making and employers, it's more men, to say we're not having that. We're not going to take that. We're going to value the fact that you are doing this, but we're going to ensure that there is full equity. And so, you know, so in some countries, and Marian will be more up to date on some of these, we have corporations and enterprise that fully publish all of what everybody's getting paid, and wow, that has a pretty stunning effect. It's not the only thing, I think, but I think, you know, that's certainly something I think is well and truly overdue.
Well, it is interesting because Australia does have a leading program in terms of reporting. So what companies do actually provide to the Workplace Gender Equality Agency is world class. What's interesting is that I think on the latest figures it's less than a quarter of those organisations who are forced to report on their pay have actually done an audit themselves. So, I mean, they've got all that information there. They're required to report and they do report, but only a quarter or less act on it. And it is interesting because I have interviewed a number of... kudos to them. There's a couple of male CEOs and managing partners of law firms who have come out and said, I didn't think the pay gap existed. I thought, why on earth would we pay men any more than we pay women? And they did. Henry Davis York is one law firm that did it. And the pay gap was about 20%. And so they set about changing it. The same. The CEO of Channel 10 did the same thing. The only way it's changed is if you actually look into your data, assess the problem, and then you change it. But there doesn't seem to be... That's not happening nearly enough. Now, we have got a question here from Emily, and she says, soul mother poverty seems to be largely ignored by mainstream feminism at a time when feminist activism is increasing. When it comes to women's economic security, issues such as the gender pay gap dominate discussion. We're guilty of that. However, this is one small part of the equation for soul mothers. How can we encourage more debate and action around soul mother poverty and women and class more broadly?
I think it's a great question. I mean, I've certainly, you know, thought a lot about this, personally having, been in an environment where we're very strongly looking at sort of gender policy issues, and then, more recently being in the Australian Council of Social Service, where there's a very strong focus on particularly for people on low incomes. Mm-hmm. And that the experience of, in any sort of, how you identify, your lived experience can be very different depending on your economic circumstances. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we should just say, well, it's up to wealthier women to carry the charge for lower income women. But I do think, collectively, for us to, in some people say, oh, look, what we've forgotten to do is continue to talk about class. Now, whether that's the term you want to use or something else, economic circumstances, I absolutely think it's crucial that we ground our discussions in what I might call some of the bread and butter circumstances of families, because one of the issues is that, of course, in every day, in the lived experience, you will choose to be where you can depending on what you're dealing with. And if you are on very, very low incomes, and I've given you the very clear picture about the level of poverty and how that particularly affects single parents, and overwhelmingly that is about women and their children, you will be making a decision today to work on finding more employment, which is absolutely what women are trying to do, rather than being involved in what might be seen as the loftier debates about number of women on boards.
Yes.
And so collectively we need to be going, where does our collective voice need to be at any given time? And I certainly think this is, an example of where we've absolutely wanted to call it out across the board, see the connection between the two, but can't assume, for example, that if you fix gender equality on boards,
yes,
we're going to be dealing with the issues of women who genuinely do not have $5 at the end of a week to enable their child to go and do a bit of sport. And, we've had this relentless push from government. It was Labor that started it during Julia Gillard's prime ministership, where they cut single parent payments. It affected, and as a result, we've done the analysis. We've seen an increase in the child poverty rate as a result of that measure that was done under the Labor government. They increased the age pension, but they cut the income. So I think it's a good debate for us to continue to have about the public perception of being a single parent. I think that there is a less tolerance to this notion that, we've had a politician quite recently have a crack, right? It's just appalling. It's got to stop. It's appalling. It's absolutely appalling. It's disgraceful. And of course, more power to the single parents that have absolutely mobilised to be speaking up, particularly low paid, and in low economic circumstances, and, being proud of the really important work they do. It's one of the, personally, I can't stand the term jobless families, because I can tell you, if you're in a family and you've got kids, you're working very, very hard to make ends meet and, look after your kids at the same time.
But I think also it is such a pity. I think Bob Hawke did us no favours back in the 80s when he declared no child shall live in poverty, because it's like we haven't been able to talk about child poverty since then. So sole parent poverty is very tied up with child poverty and the fact that we're not doing enough about that and we're not talking about it. And I don't necessarily think it's the job of feminism as a movement to do that, but I do think as a society, what kind of society do we live in that we don't care that children are missing out and missing out every day and missing out every weekend because we're not prepared to address the horrific rates of child poverty that we have in this country. And we need to talk about it and we need to blow the... The other problem, I think, is that family payments became mired in a debate about middle-class welfare for a while. And so the assumption was that all family payments were therefore middle-class welfare. Mm. And indeed, I know ACOS and Early Childhood Australia supported early rounds of cuts to family tax benefits that, for that reason. They were poorly targeted. They were going to families that didn't need them. Mm. But we've done that hard work. There are no middle-class welfare payments these days. Mm. And the cuts that we're talking about now are cutting much deeper to low-income families. And it's time we all got concerned about that, I think, not just the feminists or the women, but everybody. Mm.
In the 30th anniversary year, though, of the famous... commitment from Prime Minister Hawke, he delivered. It's not the story that gets told, but with the policies, and it was about family payments, he reduced the level of child poverty by a full 30% as a result of that. And so that's the story we need to be reminding ourselves, that these are structured because of this persistent... push to again to see family payments as middle class welfare. Mm-hmm. I think during the coalition era, John Howard also did have an understanding of where the family payment system, what the architecture of it was very important in the way it interacted with wages. Mm. So this idea that it's sort of, it's to say, okay, the wage fixing arrangement we've got in Australia, the minimum wage case is about the right level of payment of wage for a single person. Mm. Now, there are those that advocate we should have the right level of wage to ensure that a single person can look after a partner and two children. We don't think that's the right move, but this is what family payments was meant to do, was to provide the right kind of retargeting from tax revenues to ensure that there was enough income in a family if you had one person working, at the right time, that calibration, the right level of income. And family payments is therefore extremely important in terms of protecting from child poverty, and it's woefully inadequate now. Mm.
Mm. Marian, do you think feminism is failing single mothers?
Look, I'm glad you came back to that, really, Georgie, because I've been thinking about that a lot. Look, feminism, no, I don't think it has, but feminism has so many other issues it's also dealing with at the same time. And within feminism and feminist groups, there are groups who have particular interest on single mothers or on a policy. But I wouldn't say that we have forgotten that. But I do think it's something to remember, and I constantly sort of have to rethink this myself, that a lot of our policies are really shaped around still a norm of a couple with two children in a household. Mm. And when that's the beginning of your policy development, then it's not very long before you see that people who don't fit that pattern fall out of the debate, fall out of the... policy parameters, and the policy doesn't work for them. So I do think it's a good reminder. So thank you to the person who asked the question that we do have to think about the different ways in which households, families are formed, and how do we need to protect and enable them to contribute to the community that we all want to live in. Because the inequalities are what leads to divisions. Mm. And we want to make sure that we don't live in an economy, we live in a society. Mm. And we have to make that society work. Mm. And we have to protect those who need that protection, vulnerable children, parents, particularly women, because they are mostly the ones taking the responsibility, who don't have the income. And, of course, there's that whole shift in the whole policy debate, not just in Australia but everywhere. And Cass, you'd know much more about this than I do, but it's that rhetoric now that you have to work in order to be entitled to some payment from the government as well. And women who are single mothers looking after children, asking them to work as well in cities where it's so expensive to live and to travel, I think becomes an almost impossible hurdle for them. Mm. And the policies, we just have to somehow, we have to really be conscious of that and design policies that are able to address those problems.
I mean, I think, you know, we're obviously, for all the right reasons, importantly talking about women today on International Women's Day and women's perspective on all of this. I don't think anybody sitting here is, the message is, oh, we just want men to get out of the way.
Not at all.
You know?
Not at all.
I think the very serious concern we all bring today is that we've got male decision makers that are not following the expert advice in areas which we know particularly affect women and children. And it is, you know, I've been so struck by some of the reactions where you have a leader, you know, the Canadian Prime Minister, where, you know, literally just putting that, being prepared to name, I am a feminist too. And yet in contrast, I am trying to remember the last time we had the Prime Minister give a wide-ranging speech on gender equality in Australia and frame that up as one of his priorities.
Priorities.
Well, at this time I am talking about the current Prime Minister and to really speak to that agenda. It is not about political correctness. You know, this is a term that gets used to try and shut down very important changes that we have yet to deliver on. And gender equality is one of them.
But I think back to your point, Georgie, too, is we've lost the scrutiny of how we're tracking and whether we are making a difference. So we used to have reports in the budget cycle that looked at what are the impacts on women.
Well, we did. That's right. And we've called
and
for
we don't
the gender...
That,
no, that's been dropped.
That
that's right.
And we don't have the data being published, but we have in recent weeks, which is very interesting because it's like this International Women's Day, there seems to be much more focus attention on some of the data that's been released lately that does suggest that we're not tracking in a progressive upwards direction, that we're actually losing ground on
some
of these issues.
Definitely.
Look, we've got one other question. We've just got a few more minutes. But Vesna has asked, what do you think it is about Swedish and German societies that make them so much more active in pursuing equality compared to Australia?
I'll start that one if you like. I mean, I think Sweden more than Germany, so let's talk about Sweden.
Yes.
Their gender equality ethos goes back a long way. I think one of the important things in Sweden is that they have a much stronger notion of what they call the social settlement or a social contract. And it's what, one of the parties in that is employers. We haven't had a chance to talk about them much today, but in Sweden, the employers, the state, the unions or labour talk about these issues of gender equality, and it's part of the national conversation, and it's just part of the policy making process. In Australia, we've gone down these separate routes historically, you know, the concept of sort of institutional legacy and the pathways you're on. It's very hard to change that, I agree, once you're on one. But when we see particular things happening, like we see at the moment, to come back to where we began about the omnibus bill, we know that if that's introduced, we are setting Australia on another direction that will be in time even harder to pull back from. So it's really important to address that now. But, you know, it's imbued now in Swedish society. Men and women participate. Men and women have policies that enable them to take time off from work and to look after children. They institute policies that say if the men don't use the leave, then they lose it and the family loses extra leave as well. So it's just a framing, it's not just, I mean, it's fundamentally a different way of framing policy, and to say that men and women are both citizens, both have the right to work and both have the right to care and both should be doing both, and to facilitate that. It's not a policy. Unfortunately, You did mention, Sam, and I think this is a really good point. We've lost the notion that we develop policy on the basis of evidence, and it's really moved to some ideological basis. But that ideology is not about gender equity or equality through society. It's some other, and I'm not even sure of the right terminology now. Many people would call it a market ideology or a neoliberal ideology. I'm not even convinced it's that. It's some mistaken ideology about perhaps a business-driven motive that doesn't necessarily make sense, as you've said, Cass.
And very much individual responsibility. Yeah.
Well, that is the big shift. That is the enormous shift that's happened, that the responsibility is on each individual, not a community, to respond to these problems.
Yes. And whenever we put out statements about early education, we'll get some people saying, well, children should be the individual responsibility of the parent that had them, and not seen as a social investment.
I know.
That's something that I don't think was such a strong sentiment a decade ago.
What we don't tend to do is track the sentiment.
I
actually think that we shouldn't underestimate the significant real shifts that have happened in social expectation and social norms. As you know, there are many, many men who are wanting to have much more flexible arrangements to genuinely, of course, want to spend more time with the children. Mm. You know, if there are two parents as a couple, that, you know, there's a compact, that's what we want to do. And then increasingly, again, the system around has not changed and it becomes impossible. And then we hear these stories of, in the end, I gave up.
That's right. And we have to end.
Yes. We do. Thank you so much, Marian and Cass and Sam, for taking part. And thank you, everyone who logged on and participated. Mm. We hope that you found the discussion illuminating. And I'm hopeful that we can keep up the resistance, so perhaps prevent this omnibus bill from going through in its current form. Mm. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.